Good morning. Please stand so we can worship together.
For the very first time, maybe you're watching us for the very first time, we'd like to thank you for joining us this morning, whether you're in-house or watching online. Thank you for bringing the church in with you today. A couple of quick announcements as we start our service today. Of course, VBS. Yes, VBS. We'll be starting this Tuesday evening from 6 to 8. So that will be this Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday night. For those of you that are participating and serving, we want to thank you for being a part. Those of you that are not, we can ask please to pray for us that week and pray for very specific things. Of course, number one, above all, for salvation, for heart change. We want to see these kids come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. So please be in prayer for those kiddos as they come on campus. Number two, pray for no rain. I know that can seem kind of scary, praying on a summer afternoon, especially in Central Florida, where it rains every day at like 3 o'clock. Pray that it doesn't rain. And so, of course, with the building wet, with the lawn wet, it complicates some of our programming, and it creates a greater risk of injury. So we don't want rain, okay? Well, all the rain can come on Friday when we're done, but not on Tuesday to Thursday, okay? So please, if you could pray for that rain to cease during those days, we'd greatly appreciate it. Of course, pray free from injury as well. We would greatly appreciate it. And also pray for our volunteers, just for stamina, for energy, from empowerment of the Holy Spirit as we are ministering to those kids that week. So please, please, please keep this in prayer. Of course, Big Top Bible Heroes is our theme this year, and so we're so excited. Of course, that starts Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday from 6 to 8 p.m. Please keep that time in prayer. We would greatly, greatly, greatly appreciate it. If you are one and you haven't registered your kiddo yet, or maybe you're watching online, you want to bring them, you're in town, if you're in the area in Lakeland, bring them over, even if you're walking in that Tuesday evening. We'd love to register you and your child. Of course, the event is completely free. We'd love to have them here and join us in the next couple of days. Hey, if you missed it last week, of course, we made our giant grand announcement of our rebrand to Church at Edgewood. So we're kind of in transit. We're in the process of doing this. Of course, that means all things on property. When you call the church office and the voicemail picks up, I mean, all these little things that you don't think of until you're in the moment and then you're into the weeds. So be in prayer as we do that. But we are so excited about this direction in which the Lord is leading us. Of course, as we said last week, just to reiterate, what does that mean for us? Nothing. It's business as usual. Nothing changes. We function exactly how we always have. We're about God's word just like how we always have. We study through books of the Bible, chapter by chapter, verse by verse. That's what we've always done. I'm not going anywhere, and we're excited about this in the upcoming years and see what the Lord will do through this. So we're excited about reaching our community like that in a very powerful, powerful, and positive way. Hey, also, a couple of fall dates to give you. So make sure, I always tell you during our message, pen, pencil, lipstick, mascara to take notes. Right now, write these dates down. Our groups, community groups, will be launching on August 13th. We like to align with the school calendar. And so what that does, it allows us to be family friendly. We're aware when people are out of town, when kids are starting school, of course, there's a big transition. And so usually we like to kick off the week after school starting. That gives families and kids a week to acclimate, a week to get back on their routine. So August 13th is when our groups kick off. Remember, our community groups are sermon-based. Around this time, we'll be starting our Jonah series, We Are Jonah, so we're going to be kicking off groups, discussing that book in our groups together. And so, of course, August 13th is that first Sunday for community groups. August 16th will be our first Wednesday back, and that's when we go back into that routine. Awana will be launching, our student ministry will be launching, and do not forget, we'll have a special study called Route 66 will also be taking place. We'll give you a little bit more details on that in the upcoming weeks. Route 66 will be an accelerated pace. On Sunday morning, I was talking to somebody prior to church today. We were in chapter 15 in 1 Corinthians, and we were there for about 4 weeks, okay? We were starting to collect mail at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, and that's okay. We want to make sure we take our time and really get what the Lord is telling us through the scripture. Amen? So today, I promise we're not in 15, we're in 16. We finished the book of 1 Corinthians today. So we are excited about that to move on beyond that book. But on Wednesday night, it'll be more accelerated. We'll be covering half of a book or perhaps a whole book in one evening. It'll be the Bible at a 30,000 foot approach. And so if you've never, and we're going to go from cover to cover, we're going to start in Revelation, go all the way through, start from Genesis all the way. Good morning. Making sure you're drinking your coffee. Starting from Genesis all the way to Revelation. And so it'll be a great time together. Of course, we'll be meeting in-house for that study for Route 66. We say Route 66 because there's 66 books of the Bible. And so Route 66 will be taking place. They also will be live streaming. We'll be live streaming it just like we do on a Sunday morning. And they will also be archived. So you can also go after the fact and find the messages online. Those of you that are watching online, join us. We'd love to have you. If you're not in town for Lakeland, join us online, or you can find us on the archive afterwards. So a lot of exciting things happening. Believe it or not, fall is just in a couple of weeks, our fall kickoff here at Edgewood, where we go back to normal, and we're into the grind. Once school starts, we're going. We break briefly till Thanksgiving, and then we're back after that. So, you know, this is kind of that stretch all the way through for the next couple of months. So we're excited to get back in routine. Amen. Back in routine is good. I sorely miss that. Hey, here at Edgewood, prior to our service, we like to get together and read God's word together as a congregation. I'm going to ask you, if you do not have a Bible, please slip your hand up. We'd love to get it to you. Joaquin and Eric are going to be available to hand a Bible to you. So if you came in today without Bible in hand, raise your hand. We'll put a Bible in your hand. If you don't own a Bible, take it home. It's your gift. It's yours for free. You take it home. But if you do have your Bible, I'm going to invite you to please join me in Psalm chapter 139. In our Bible, that's on page 292 in our Bible, but that's going to be in Psalm 139. If you're brand new to the Bible, you're brand new to this Jesus thing, you're brand new to this church thing, if you open up the Bible about middle of the way, more than likely, you're going to hit the book of Psalms. So if you open it halfway, you're going to be in Psalms. Join us in Psalm 139. And we're going to ask if you are physically able to please stand and join us as we read God's word together, as we read it out loud together corporately. We're going to be in Psalm 139, starting in verse 1. So let's read that together this morning. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, and your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful, and I know them full well. God bless to us the reading of his word this morning as we study the scripture. Could you please look around, maybe find a neighbor, or learn three names you didn't know 5 minutes ago. You greet one another in the name of the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus, we do thank you for this morning. God, we do thank you for the privilege, the honor we have to gather together in your house, in your home, in your house. And Father, I do pray blessings as we begin this Bible study. Father, I thank you for every person here under the sound of my voice. We thank you for those that are watching online. And Holy Spirit, we pray, would you use this vessel to your glory? Holy Spirit, would you equip me and empower me this morning in a powerful way? I pray, of course, Lord, as individuals here are hearing me talk, that they would not hear me talk, they would hear you talk, and they would hear your words, and they would hear your promise, and they would hear your goodness and your faithfulness. And so, Father, we want to make much of who you are. So, Lord, we surrender this time, we give this time back to you, we lay it down at your feet, King Jesus. And it's in Jesus' name in which we all pray this morning. And all of Edgewood said today, amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. So this morning, we are concluding, we are ending our time together in 1 Corinthians. We're going to be in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Okay, good. We're in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. I like how somebody just said, no. No, we're not. No, we're not. I love that. Good. So 1 Corinthians chapter 16, making sure you're paying attention. We are saying goodbye to 1 Corinthians. And so usually when we end a book, I kind of like feel like I'm getting ready to say goodbye to a friend. So I kind of get, it's kind of bittersweet. I'm excited to go on to the next, but at the same time, I'm like, oh man, I'm going to miss this one. So again, I've been reiterating this the past couple of weeks. While you get to 1 Corinthians chapter 16, we say goodbye to 1 Corinthians today. Next week, we're kind of like an in-between time. And so next week, we're going to do what we call in the church world a standalone. That'll be like a message in-between series. And so that week will be something different out of a book. The week after that, the first week of August, we are kicking off a series called We Are Jonah. Jonah is a fast-paced book. It's action-packed. It's very light in many areas. That'll be a four-week study. That'll be in and out of Jonah. And then at the end of that, we're going to be jumping into a series called Unveiled, and that'll be a study going through the book of Revelation. And so we wanted to put the standalone, and we wanted to put Jonah before Revelation to kind of lighten that up a little bit, if you will. So you're welcome. You'll thank me when we get there. But Jonah will be a great study. Revelation, if you've never studied the book of Revelation from chapter to chapter, verse by verse, man, you're in for a treat. I promise you, it'll change your life. I know it sounds intimidating. I know it sounds like, that's kind of scary. That's kind of freaky. It's not. Trust me, you'll be deeply ministered to and encouraged of the mighty God that we serve. So be on the lookout. A lot of exciting things happening. So this morning, 1 Corinthians chapter 16 for real. Remember, in the last couple of weeks, we've been discussing the big picture of 1 Corinthians is Paul plants this church in Corinth. He's there for a number of years. He leaves. You have several pastors that are there after him. This church in Corinth runs into a lot of problems. That's why it's called messy church, because, man, it was a messy, dysfunctional church. They bring up a delegation, and they think to themselves, we need to set up a committee, a delegation to write out to Paul, to reach out to Paul, and to ask for Paul for help. They're going to bring Paul issues. They're going to ask Paul several questions. And 1 Corinthians is Paul's response to that delegation, right? So what is Paul going to say in this long letter? Well, how is he going to close it? We'll find out this morning. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 1. If you're there this morning, say word. Let's jump in with both feet. Now, about the collection for the Lord's people. Your attention, please. That's a response to a question. So along the way, Paul's addressed, hey, Paul, what about marriage, sexuality, singleness, divorce? He addresses that. Hey, Paul, what about food that's served in the temple? Are we to eat this? Are we not to eat this? Paul addresses that. Hey, Paul, what about the gathering? What is the gathering supposed to look like? What is worship supposed to look like? The whole issue with speaking in tongues or not speaking in tongues, what do we do with that? And he addresses that there. Remember the last one. Hey, Paul, what about the resurrection, the second coming of Jesus? Remember that church in Corinth, because of their background, their Greek heritage, they had an issue with bodily resurrection. And Paul tells them, remember, you'll recall a couple weeks ago, hey man, if you eliminate that resurrection, you got a lot of weird teaching that comes into the church, right? Without the resurrection, this means nothing. So Paul addresses it. So apparently, one of the last questions they had was, hey Paul, tell us about this offering that you're collecting. So verse 1, let's put that lens in. Now about the collection for the Lord's people. Do what I told the Galatian churches to do. Okay, so right off the bat, you have your note sheet in front of you. Paul answers questions in chapter 16 about the offering. Write that down. So the very thing, what's he going to close with? Talking about the offering. Paul, when he says, do what I told you, that word told in the original language is to direct, to command, and to kind of instruct. So when Paul says, hey, do this, he's not kind of leaving it for an area of debate, right? 1 Corinthians 16:1, just to jump back, I'll read it to you. As I have given order to the churches of Galatia. So write this down. That offering is a non-negotiable. Write that down. This is a non-negotiable, okay? So we know he's talking about, he's collecting an offering from the church in Corinth, and it's non-negotiable. Now, while you're writing this down, keep in mind, Paul never collected money for himself. Paul always collected money for someone else. Who is he collecting for? I'm glad you asked. I must have told you this. If you've been around Edgewood for a period of time, I must have told you this 100 times. There is a homiletical exercise we always exercise or use here when we go through God's word. The homiletical exercise goes like this. In order to get the context from the scripture, we have to ask the questions, who wrote it, who's it being written to, and what's happening in history? Who wrote this? Paul. Who's he writing it to? That church in Corinth. What's happening in history? Well, this church in Corinth is beginning to grow. Their people are coming to know the Lord. They're in their Greek culture that has a lot of difficulty and confusion. That's why Paul's bringing clarity to it. The church in Jerusalem is going through a tremendous amount of hardship. The church in Jerusalem is going through a famine. That means resources are drying up, food is drying up, jobs are drying up, money is not as available as it was. We also know, according to history, there was an increasing number of amount of widows there in that church in Jerusalem. Multiple reasons. A lot of it was because of persecution. A lot of those early believers were being killed or incarcerated or driven off or whatever the case may be. So Paul is collecting a new, an offering for this church in Corinth. For the church in Jerusalem, if you were a believer in that church in Jerusalem and you were caught professing Christ or following the way or involved in the church, you were excommunicated from your community, which means they would lose their job, they would lose their livelihood, and many of them lost their homes. Great need in that church in Jerusalem. Church in Corinth didn't quite have that type of difficulty. They didn't have that kind of situation going on, but that church in Jerusalem did, and here Paul is addressing them and collecting an offering for them. Does that make sense? Does that make sense? So Paul isn't saying, like these guys on TV, our ministry is really hurting, and if you sow a seed of $20, the Lord will repay you 20-fold. So write your check out to the Apostle Paul, Apostle Paul Ministries, send it to me today, and if you send it to me, I'll give you this free book or free mug. Paul's not doing that. Paul never collected money for himself to fund himself. Paul was a tent maker by trade, so he always supported himself aside from the church. Every time he collects money, it's for someone else. Make sense? Verse 2, on the first day of every week, so he's going to instruct them what this offering looks like. On the first day of every week, each one of you should set aside a sum of money in keeping with your income. Okay, so we'll go ahead and unpack this in a couple seconds. Saving it up, so that when I come, no collection will have to be made. Your attention, please. So Paul is saying, I'm going to go collect this money. We're going to support this church. We're going to support these believers in Jerusalem who desperately need our help. He's saying, collect it. That way, when I get there, we're not passing a plate. You've saved it. You're going to give it to our people, which he's going to disclose. He's not going to collect it himself. He's going to have other people to do it because Paul's trying to be above reproach. He doesn't want it to appear like Paul just took the money and he ran. He gives it to a group of people that then brings it to the church in Jerusalem. Paul's just the mouthpiece, okay? So on your outline, write this down. When it comes to that offering, when, right? And you'll see in the quotations, every week. And the point is to be done regularly, right? So the idea is that it's a habit. So whatever habits you have of moving your body for 30 minutes a day, drinking water, eating more greens, Bible study, prayer, whatever your habit is, the idea is that the idea of giving should be regular. It shouldn't be sporadic. It should be indeed a habit. On your handout, what day? You'll see in quotations, the first day, which according to that context is Sunday. Remember, Paul, having a Jewish background in Israel, grown up in Israel, the Orthodox Jews still to this day observe their holy day on Saturday. So Saturday is when the Orthodox Jews, they will walk to the temple. Remember, it's their Sabbath. So for them, driving is labor. It's work. They're not allowed to do it because it's the Sabbath. They walk to the synagogue. They walk to the temple. It came through tradition. We started observing the Lord's Day on Sunday because that was the day that Jesus resurrected from the dead, right? Easter Sunday. So then that's how that tradition kept up. So he's alluding to that first day, Sunday, which, by the way, you want to worship God, you should worship God every day, not just Sunday. You know this, right? It's a lifestyle. It's your life. So when do I worship God? Let me help you. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. Amen? Right? So it's not just a one day a week thing. Now, who participates? You'll notice in quotations on your handout, each one. The idea is no one is exempt. The idea is no one is exempt. The idea is everyone has their part. Everyone has their share. It has nothing to do with quantity. It has to do with your heart. You'll recall in the Gospels, Jesus smiles at a widow who goes with her widow's mite and gives it at the temple. You'll recall in the Gospels referring to a tax collector going into the temple to pray, right? And the Pharisee going to the temple to pray. And what does the Pharisee say? Thank God that I'm a Pharisee, that I'm not a woman, and that I'm not this tax collector. What does a tax collector do? He prostrates himself before the Lord and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And what God is saying, he's more pleased with that tax collector than he is with that Pharisee. It's not about the outside, it's about the heart. It's not about the quantity, it's about the heart. Now, you'll notice on your handout, set aside in the quotations implies a set amount. A set amount. So it's a set amount. It's not based on guilt. It's not based on shame. Listen, I'm going to say this, and hopefully I don't want to be offensive, but we try not to do this here at Edgewood, but I've seen this happen at churches. Maybe you have as well. We do the give by guilting or participate by guilting. You know how we do. It's time for like children's ministry. We need more workers. They bring up a little Sally here in tears and say, I just will never learn the Bible if I don't have a teacher up here. You know, we can't do this unless we have someone help us. And they usually guilt the church, okay? We don't want to guilt you. We want to make sure God has called you to do that, right? So he says set them out because it doesn't have to do with guilt and it doesn't have to do with emotion. Does that make sense? Does that make sense? Okay. The next one on your handout, in keeping with his income, it applies proportion. It implies proportion, so write that down. So those are the kind of the major details. Everybody with me so far? Yeah, okay, good. So what exactly is the proportion? What is the proportion? So I'm going to go back. You can hear along, if you want to read along, 1 Corinthians, let's revisit chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 13. I will read it to you. This has to do with the proportion. Don't you know that those who work in the temple get their meals from the food brought to the temple as offerings, which we've talked about earlier in the book, and those who serve at the altar get a share of the sacrificial offering. Verse 14, in the same way, the Lord gave orders that those who preach the good news should not be supported by those who benefit from it, right? So he's talking about, again, the heart behind it, the intent behind it, not necessarily quantity. So write this down. What is the proportion? On your handout, the tithe is the 10%. Paul never mentions this because tithing is an Old Testament teaching. He's going to talk about other things of supporting. That's why he doesn't bring it up specifically here. But there is a difference between the tithe and the offering. There's a difference between tithe and offering. The tithe is what you give the Lord first fruit. It is the 10%. It's God, here's my first fruit. I'm going to honor you. I'm going to obey you in this. The offering is anything that's above and beyond that, right? So that's where your Compassion International, CBM, Camp Gilead, Student Leadership University, whatever nonprofit ministry you want to give to, that goes above and beyond that. Why does God say this? Is it to help keep the lights on? Not entirely. Is it to support staff? Not entirely. Is it to do programming? Not entirely. According to the scripture, Deuteronomy 14:23, listen to this, Deuteronomy 14:23. The purpose of tithing is to teach you always to put God first in your lives. The purpose of tithing is to always teach you to put God first in your lives. Your attention, please. God doesn't need your money. And God will always support and provide for the church. Jesus said to Peter and the boys, the gates of hell cannot prevail against the church. Nothing can stop this vehicle, the bride of Christ, the church, right? So, of course, there's practical ways of tithing, of course, supports a ministry, supports growth, supports outreach. But the idea is not your checkbook. The idea is not your money. The idea is not keeping the bills on for the organization. The idea is your heart. Here's the idea. You going to the Lord and saying, God, I trust you. I trust by giving this 10%, you will provide the 90%. That's it. It's a heart posture. It's a way to say, Lord, this is it. Can I be honest with you? And during 2020, we kind of switched things around. We stopped touching things during the pandemic. And then when we started coming back together as a church, we started limiting some things. And can I be honest? The flesh in me got really nervous. This is one of the first things I thought. I was like, we're not going to pass a plate. Uh-oh. How are we going to do this? Are we going to have enough? We have not passed a plate since 2020. Since, I'm telling you, we stopped passing a plate, we've always had enough. And the last couple of years, we've replaced a roof. We've painted a building. We've replaced a floor in our fellowship hall. By the way, if you haven't seen that yet, it looks snazzy. It looks snazzy. Those who are in charge of that did a great job with that. Much props and thank you to them. We were able to pay for all of these things in cash. We don't put it on credit card. If we can't afford it, we don't buy it. God has provided for us more than we could ever want or ask. And it all happened when the heart decided, you know, we're going to trust the Lord on this. We're going to trust the Lord on this. And he has provided all along the way. We are a church that's not in debt. We are debt free. I told you, we've bought these things with cash. Amen? God provides. God provides. And so God always provides for his church, and it starts with the heart. Let me tell you, I love American history. There's an individual, I just learned of her a couple years ago. Her name is Hetty Green. I wish I had a picture of her. I should have put it there. Hetty Green. When you get home, Google her. Fascinating person. She is alive. She's around the late 1800s during the Gilded Age. Hetty Green was in today's standards, a multimillionaire. But you would never know it by the way she lived. She dressed in a black dress. They used to call her the Witch of Wall Street. She was a millionaire, owned property, owned buildings. This is the time of like the Rockefellers and all of that. And so she had all of these resources, but she lived miserly, in a very miserly way, not spending a lot of money, very, very frugal. She, according to history, would cook porridge. Not instant, not the instant oatmeal, that stuff that's overpriced at Publix. She would cook porridge on her heater. She's a multimillionaire, right? History would also tell us one of her little boys got nicked on his knee, and instead of giving her son medical attention and paying for it, she takes her son to a walk-in clinic. Now, walk-in clinics in the late 1800s are not like what they are today. If you went to the walk-in clinic in the late 1800s, that's not a good situation. That's not going to end well. Well, apparently, according to history, her son's leg had to be completely amputated because the infection got so bad, she didn't pay for doctors or medication. When Hetty Green died, and they were sorting out, her children were sorting out her affairs, they discovered they were sitting on a king's ransom. They were talking about multi-million dollar like property she had. She had millions of dollars in the late 1800s, and you would have never known by seeing her. You, dear son, dear daughter of the true living God, a son and daughter, co-heir in Christ, you sit on a king's ransom. Your future and the kingdom far surpasses no matter what you can ever own, buy, invest in here. You know that. Your best days and your ransom is to come down the road. Amen? Amen? We sit on a king's ransom. So for us, it's the heart of saying, God, you provide the money. You provide the resources. I'm going to honor you in this. And so I would encourage you, if you are not tithing, by the way, I would never tell you something that I don't do because that's hypocrisy. So my family and I, we tithe. We also give other things and support missionaries and other things. Our church, our ministry, we tithe too. We wanted to put our money where our mouth is. We're not going to tell you to do something that we don't do. And I'm telling you, God will honor it. God will bless you, and God will provide for you in ways that you cannot imagine. Sound good? All right, let's go continue on in the text. Verse 3. Then, when I arrive, I will give letters of introduction to the men you approve and send them with your gift to Jerusalem. Again, your attention, please. When I arrive, I will give letters of introduction to the men and approve and send them with your gift to Jerusalem. Of course, Paul is being above reproach. He's saying in writing, don't give me the money. He doesn't even touch the money. These other guys do, and they deliver the money. By the way, they're mentioned at the very end of the book, and he will name them, and we'll see that when we get there in a couple of minutes. He gives them a shout out in the letter. Verse 4, if it seems advisable for me to go also, they will accompany me. So again, Paul being above reproach. We should always be above reproach in every area. Paul always says, be above reproach. What that means is live in such a way where nobody can accuse you or say anything of you. Live in such a way where nobody can accuse you or say anything of you. You must be above reproach, as Paul would say. Verse 5, after I go through Macedonia, I will come to you, for I will be going through Macedonia. Verse 6, perhaps I will stay with you for a while or even spend the winter so that you can help me on my journey wherever I go. Excuse me, verse 7, for I do not want you to see, I do not want to see you now and make only a passing visit. I hope to spend time with you. I just learned how to read. I hope to spend time with you if the Lord permits. Let's try this. Verse 8. Come on, Roger. Verse 8. But I will stay on at Ephesus until Pentecost. You note takers, circle, highlight, underline Ephesus. That's modern day Turkey. Modern day Turkey. So we know today a situation in Turkey in terms of church planting is not very favorable. There's a lot of persecution there, and there hasn't been a lot of planting really in that area publicly because of their situation there. Verse 9, because a great door for effective work has been opened to me, and there are many who oppose me. So several takeaways. The first one, write this down on your handout. Paul says, I'll do it if the Lord permits. I'll do it if the Lord permits. So we see Paul. Paul, we know according to history, we believe that Paul, when he was executed, Paul lived up to be 58 years old. So we can kind of calculate he's somewhere in his maybe late 40s to mid 50s. Around that time, Paul is when he's writing this. So Paul is saying here, we make plans. So if you're someone who does not make plans, it's good to plan. You must know plan. Plan accordingly. So if you're someone who doesn't like to make a plan, plan. Have a plan. Have something in mind. Paul did. Have a plan. Those of us, those of you, we, us, thou, thy, if you are somebody who's so rigid with your plan, here's a word for you too. Blessed are the flexible, for they shall not be bent out of shape. Okay? So we can learn something from both. If you're not a planner, plan. If you're somebody who's super rigid with that plan, bend the knees, be flexible, right? Be flexible. So that's what Paul is trying to say there. Make sense? Amen, amen? Okay, so Paul right there at the very end of that verse faces opposition. I want to come to you, but he faces opposition. Let's put our thinking caps on this. This is the Apostle Paul, okay? Paul. He writes the majority of the New Testament. You kind of figure this guy glows in the dark. You kind of figure he's involved in ministry. His ministry must have been a breeze because he's doing it for the Lord. Not exactly. Like a Lee Corso would say, not so fast, my friend. Why? On your handout, you see this when it doesn't work out. When it doesn't work out. So if you're somebody like Paul and you're facing some opposition in your ministry or what you're doing, write these down. It does not mean that you're unspiritual. It does not mean that you're unspiritual, because if it meant that you're unspiritual, that disqualifies Paul, right? And we would agree, Paul, who wrote the majority of the New Testament, was a pretty spiritual guy, right? He knew the Lord. He had a relationship with God. Write this down as well. Remember that you didn't miss it. You didn't miss it. We'll get into this a little bit more next week. How do I know if God called me to do that? What do I know what God is calling me to? Is there a litmus test? Is there a process? Are there questions I should ask? That's next week. We'll get there. But here's the reality. We have to remember that we didn't miss it. Like, how do I know it's God or it's the Taco Bell I ate last night? How do I know if it's like divine calling or indigestion? How do I know the difference, right? And so Paul will see he is obedient. He's going to have some calamity. He's going to have some setbacks. He's going to have some problems, but God very much is in it. The next one, seek the Lord for what is next. Seek the Lord for what is next. So maybe you are facing some opposition. Things are hard. And you're thinking, maybe God's not in it. I would submit to you, hang in there, be faithful. Maybe start asking the Lord what is next. For some of us, sometimes the Lord isn't calling you to leave. God's calling you to do differently. God's calling you to pivot. That's for you Ross Geller Friends fans, right? He's calling you to pivot and to do it differently than how you've done it before. That's a possibility as well. Lastly, write this down too. This is important. Don't blame other people. Don't blame other people. Don't blame other people. You take responsibility for your actions, and you assess and see where you are. Now, as you've written that down, our culture is very instant. Our culture is very fast. Guardians of the Galaxy is one of this summer's most highest gross box office movie, you know, in the movie theaters, Guardians of the Galaxy. It came out of the theaters last week. It comes out on streaming devices August 1st. You remember back in the day when a movie came out of the theater, it was like a year later till it came out on VHS? Who has time for that and who has patience? Now it's a month later, and now it's available to stream, it's available to buy, because our culture has become so instant. We don't want to wait. We go on Amazon Prime, and you get it in less than 2 days sometimes. I want it now. I want the popcorn button, and who has time to stand there for a minute and 30 seconds, right? Our culture is now, and it's instant. It's now, and it's instant. We want it now. The things of the kingdom, when it comes to spirituality, when it comes to ministry, it doesn't work that way. It's not instant. God doesn't work on our timetable. God doesn't work on our time frame. His timing is always perfect, but it's not on our timing. So let me put it this way. If you're someone who is serving, you are involved in a business, involved in a ministry, involved in things that you're doing for the Lord, for the kingdom, and you face opposition. Usually when we face opposition, what do? Sayonara. We leave. We quit. And we often ask the question, maybe God's not in it. Maybe I missed it. Maybe I missed a turn. Maybe I missed what's going on here. May I tell you this, Christian? May I give you a different perspective? If you face opposition and it's hard, you're probably on the right track. You're probably on the right track. Why? Because you have an enemy. You have an adversary who hates you. He wants to steal, kill, and destroy. Scripture would say they call Satan the tempter and the accuser. He wants to kill you, destroy you, your family, your legacy, your testimony. He wants to completely strip you of it. Remember, Satan can't take your salvation. You can't lose your salvation. He can't take your salvation away. But what does Satan do? He distracts you so you're ineffective. He distracts you so there's no movement. He distracts you so that you're no earthly or kingdom or heavenly good. Make sense? That's what Satan does. So this word goes to maybe somebody here or somebody watching online, and you find yourself in a difficult situation. Maybe, just maybe, don't quit. Don't give up. Press in. Could it just be that you just ticked off Satan? You ticked off Satan, and he's turning up the heat. He's turning up the heat. You're thinking, I'm on the right track. Amen? Amen? Because now we're going to face that opposition. Paul's going to say this, chapter 16, verse 9. Because a great door for effective work has opened to me. And what does he say? And there are many who oppose me. Not only Satan, but human. There's a human element to this as well. So write this down on your handout. When God calls you to do something, it doesn't mean that everything will go smoothly. Write that down, okay? When God calls you to do something, it doesn't mean that everything will go smoothly. Remember what we said, our culture's fast, it's instant, it's all about convenience. I get in the drive-thru, I expect Chick-fil-A to order this hot, not on Sunday, they're closed. I expect it to be hot, fresh, and fast, right? It's our culture, it's go, go, go. We're also very pain avoidant. The old motto used to be no pain, no gain. Our culture today says no pain, no pain. We're very pain avoidant. We want to avoid pain at all costs. Here's what I'm telling you. Lean in. There's things to learn. God's teaching you something. No need to go there. I'll read this to you. 1 Corinthians, I almost feel funny saying this, chapter 15. Remember that verse or that chapter? 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 31. I'll read this to you. Here's Paul. I face death every day. Right? So Paul's saying, I'm facing danger every single day. My life is literally on the line. I face death every day. Just as surely as I boast about you in Christ Jesus our Lord, if I fought wild beasts in Ephesus with no more than human hopes, what have I gained? If the dead are not raised, let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. Your attention, please. Paul's saying this, hey, I've almost died multiple times. This is like the story arc of like Indiana Jones, and he's dying, almost died multiple times, and somehow he survives, and he's able to grab his hat. That's Paul. Like, he keeps ticking, he keeps moving, God preserves him, God saves him, and man, he doesn't stop, he doesn't quit. He's gonna say this, as surely as I boast about you in Christ Jesus our Lord, verse 32, if I fought wild beasts in Ephesus. You and I read that in 2023 and say, wild beasts in Ephesus. What does he mean? History will tell us the Romans had some very morbid and evil ways of torturing people. After all, remember, the Romans are the ones that invented and perfected crucifixion. That was kind of their gig. That was their thing. They specialized in torture. So one of the things the Romans would do if you opposed the Roman government, they would take an individual, not to go too PG or rated R, really, at that case. It's not PG-13, not to get too graphic or gross. They would put an individual in animal skin up to their neck, stitch them into the animal skin, and throw them to the wild animals and the wild dogs. That was a way to torture them, not to execute them. And Paul is saying to this, man, I fought and I've survived wild beasts. Paul knows this. Why? Paul not only was a Pharisee, Paul not only was a hotshot lawyer who knew the law, remember, Paul was also a Roman citizen. So he's very aware of their system of judgment, and so persecution and judgment and justice and all those things. And so Paul is alluding to that, the dangers in which he was facing. All case in point, if you are following God and you're being obedient, don't expect it to always go smoothly. Lean in. Amen? Lean in. Verse 10. Here's the scripture's going to say, verse 10. When Timothy comes, okay, Timothy is his young protege. We see 1st, 2nd Timothy when Paul writes to him directly. When Timothy comes, see to it that no one has nothing to fear while he is with you. For he is carrying on the work of the Lord just as I am. Verse 11, watch this detail. No one then should treat him with any contempt. Send him on his way in peace so that he may return to me, I expecting him along with the brothers. Your attention, please. Remember, Paul started this church in Corinth. Paul was the first pastor. After Paul, there was a guy named Apollos. We're going to see him again in a couple seconds. Apollos, remember, was the rock star pastor. Paul was very chapter by chapter, verse by verse, systematic. Apollos came after him. He's what's known as the rock star pastor, right? With the flash and the pizzazz, that church in Corinth grows incredibly. After Apollos, there's a third pastor. Many biblical historians and theologians believe that somewhere along the line, Peter came to pastor that church through the road there. And so now they're in need of a pastor. Now they're in the need of the fourth pastor. Now comes Timothy, the very same guy that Paul was mentoring. Paul considered Timothy to be a son in the faith, a son in the ministry. And so he puts him in place. Verse 11, he says, no one should treat him with contempt. In other words, he's saying this, Timothy's my boy, treat him well, right? Paul knows that church, he's pastored that church, he started that church, he knows how they are, and he's saying, hey, be good to my boy, right? That's all he's saying, be good to my boy Timothy. Verse 12, now about our brother Apollos, who we just mentioned a couple seconds ago, I strongly urged him to go to you with the brothers. He was quite unwilling to go now, but he will go when he has the opportunity. So write this down, a great observation this morning. Paul said, I think you should go. And Apollos said, no. Kind of sounds like a Dr. Seuss story or something, right? Paul said, I think you should go. And Apollos said, no. So Paul is saying there, apparently through the line, Paul contacts Apollos and said, hey, Apollos, this church in Corinth is going through some dysfunction. They're a little uneasy right now. Perhaps you can go and pastor there, bring some stability, bring some leadership, bring some health, right? Bring some solidarity, get their elders together, help them get their affairs in order, help them to get organized again. And Apollos simply says, no. We don't exactly know why that is. Apollos, it could be because it was hard, it was difficult, and Apollos just said, no, absolutely not, I'm not going there. But here's the lesson behind this. There's a saying in church, and it goes like this. Jesus loves you, and everybody else has a wonderful plan for your life. Anyone ever heard that? Anyone ever experienced that? I have a word for you. I have something to tell you. And usually if somebody says, I have a word for you, the spidey sense goes off and you're thinking, this is probably not from God, right? Because you're thinking, what are they going to tell me? Listen, here's what we see. Here's the spiritual principle behind this. We can learn from both Paul and Apollos on this. We need to be more like Paul. What does Paul say? Paul says, I've told Apollos to go, but he will go there eventually, when he has time, when he's able to, when he has that flexibility. Paul doesn't flex his muscle. Could Paul flex his muscle in his authority? Yes, he's Paul. After all, he's the Apostle Paul who writes the majority of the New Testament. He could have easily flexed his muscle and said, Apollos, you are to get to Corinth. You're that next pastor, pal, because I said so. What does Paul do? Paul tells Apollos, I believe God is sending you there, but you have to figure out and decipher whether God is calling you there. So we can learn this from Paul, right? We can wish, we can desire, we can encourage folks to do things, but ultimately we let the Lord tell them when to move forward. We can learn from Apollos. We can learn from Apollos, because if we're not careful, we get into the people-pleasing business, we find ourselves in all kinds of problems because we don't listen on the Lord, we listen to people. So we can learn from Apollos as well. Don't always listen to people. That's not the number one voice. Listen to the Lord. Make sense? Make sense? And so we can learn from both on those sides. Verse 13, listen to this. Be on your guard. Stand firm in the faith. Be courageous. Be strong, do everything in love. Write this down. This will be our last point as the worship team comes up. Love does what's best for the church. Write that down. Love does what's best for the church. And so that includes church discipline, that includes confronting. We see in John chapter 2, Jesus cleansing the temple because there's money changers. There's folks that are taking advantage of the less fortunate people. They're selling sin. They're selling forgiveness of sin for money. And so Jesus, what he does in his holy, righteous anger, he clears the temple. He clears the temple. So there's place for that. Love does what's best for the church. So we're in verse 15. We're going to press the gas. We're going to pump the gas a little bit. He's going to give a little detail, and then we're going to wrap up our time. Verse 15. You know that the household of Stephanas were the first converts in Achaia. They have devoted themselves to the service of the Lord's people. I urge you, brothers and sisters, to submit to each to such people and to everyone who joins in the work and labors in it. Verse 17, I was glad. Now, here are the names of the individuals who helped them and took the money and took the support to that church. I was glad when Stephanas, Fortunatus, and Dicaeus arrived because they have supplied what was lacking from you. Okay, remember how we told he gave those people when he was above reproach, gives them a shout out in the beginning? There's a shout out. Verse 18, for they refresh my spirit and yours also. Such men deserve recognition. Verse 19, the churches in the province of Asia send you greetings. Aquila and Priscilla greet you warmly in the Lord. And so does the church that meets at their house. Verse 20, all the brothers and sisters here send you greetings. Greet each other with the holy kiss. And as Americans in 2023, that's a scary sentence. Greet each other with the holy kiss. Understand, in the Middle Eastern culture, they greet with three kisses. And the Latin American culture, it's one. You go, hello. Some places in the world, there's two. There's in the Middle East, they do three. One, two, three. And that's just a lot of kissing. When he says greet each other with a holy kiss, that is a cultural thing that he deals with. By the way, if you go to Israel, they still greet each other like that. Even if you're not from there, they expect you to greet like that, okay? So you're kissing on total strangers three times. That's what he's referring to. So, one, two, three, four verses left. How does Paul conclude this letter? Verse 21. Here's Paul basically saying goodbye. I, Paul, write this greeting in my own hand. Verse 22, if anyone does not love the Lord, let that person be cursed or anathema. And then he's going to say the word that we use every single Sunday morning to close. You'll notice it. I usually end our time, worship team, concludes, I come up. I usually give some kind of challenge. I end with a priestly blessing that's found in number 6. May the Lord bless you and keep you, shine his face upon you. That's out of number 6. That is a priestly blessing. Then by the time I make it to the door, I always say to you, good morning and Maranatha. That's that word right there. Come, Lord. Maranatha means come, Lord. We end every single service by saying, Maranatha, come, Lord. Verse 23, the grace of the Lord Jesus be with you. And are you ready? Can you believe we have come to the end? Verse 24, my love to all of you in Christ Jesus. And then he closes by saying, amen. And that, my friends, is the book of 1 Corinthians. Good job. Good job. Yeah. Fascinating study, fascinating book. I hope you were challenged, and I hope that you grew and learned from that. Let's close in prayer. Father, we love you this morning. And Lord, we thank you for this incredible, incredible letter, the book of 1 Corinthians. Father, we know, of course, Paul, through the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, of course, wrote a second letter, 2 Corinthians. And so, Father, there's plenty to learn there as well. But, Father, we thank you for the ability we have to learn and to study and to get together and have this Bible study. Father, I pray, would we be edified? Would we be encouraged? Would we be challenged in your word? It's in Jesus' name in which we all pray. Amen. Amen. Please stand, worship in song, and we'll come right back to close.
Lost, but he brought me.
Thank you, worship team. And before you go, I'd like to close in prayer and lift up VBS this upcoming week. And we would ask you, please, continue to pray for VBS. Of course, those prayer requests, of course, salvation. We also are expecting walk-ins. We always have walk-ins every single year without fail. And we have discovered those are divine appointments, right? They're divine appointments. We know who the Lord knows who's going to be here before we ever start. So pray for those kids as they come. Pray for salvation. Good weather. Injury-free, receptive hearts, receptive minds. Pray for the leaders as well. But I'm going to ask you to do this. We're going to be closing together for VBS. If you don't mind joining me in prayer, if you could just extend your hand, and that's just a way of saying, yes, I surrender, I agree, I'm coming alongside. Let's close in prayer now. Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we surrender the upcoming days to you. Father, the Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday night VBS program. Lord, we do pray first. We thank you for this incredible honor and privilege to do so. We pray for the leaders involved on every aspect, the teachers, those in the kitchen, those that are behind the scenes, those that are with games and skits and worship. Father, I pray for all of those leaders. Would you help them, Father? Give them grace, mercy as they get here those nights. Would you give them energy, creativity, and places they never knew they had? Many of them are coming out of work. Many of them have already had a long day. And so, Father, I pray, Holy Spirit, would you encourage them, empower them, equip them for ministry? Lord, we do pray for parents as they are engaged. We pray for the walk-ins that have just driven by and saw the banner in the front and they want to get involved. We pray, Lord, for those kids that are coming here. We pray even now, Holy Spirit, would you cover this entire property with your presence and your power? We pray, would you prepare the hearts of those kiddos, open up their hearts, minds, and ears, that they would be receptive to the gospel and that they would be receptive to the truth. Father, we pray for salvation. We pray for life change, for regeneration. I pray for many of those kiddos. Would they look back 20, 30, 40, 50 years from now and trace back their story here, that you would use it that powerfully, Lord. Change family trees with it. Change lives with it. Change futures with that in the name of Jesus. And Father, we do pray, of course, King Jesus, that you would be glorified. In the name of Jesus, we ask. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord shine his face upon you, be gracious to you, and give you peace this week. And all of Edgewood said today, amen. God bless you and Maranatha.